Hi, welcome to Blackticulate, a podcast series featuring UK young black professionals, where we find out how they do what they do, so you can too. Or not. After all, it is your life.
Miss Ruse, say hey.
Hello.
Shayla, God, I've wanted to get you on Black Ticulate for a long time.
Hey, you're making me blush already.
And finally, we've got you. I've had to come to you. We're in your lovely home.
Thank you for coming.
No worries. Thank you for having me. So I want you to tell the audience, you do what? What hat are you wearing?
Okay, so at the moment, I'm wearing the maternity leave hat very comfortably. But I, maternity leave from my job at the Royal African Society as head of program partnerships and operations.
What does that exactly mean?
My role. So basically, coordinating the team. We work in a very kind of, I'd say, horizontal organization. Everyone's pretty autonomous and, you know, they just get on with their stuff. But there's about 8 of us in the team. So I'll be coordinating the team and reporting to the director. The Royal African Society is, the leading Africa organization. That's our tagline. But it's really like a kind of umbrella organization that brings together a lot of different constituencies. We run different programs from politics to academia. So we're working across 4 areas: politics, business, arts and culture, and academia. We have the African Affairs Journal, which is the leading journal of African studies. And we also run, well, most people would know us in London for our 2 cultural festivals, which we initiated in the last 5 years, Film Africa and Africa Rights. But we also have the Africa All-Party Parliamentary Group, a news and analysis site called African Arguments, as well as a book series, the African Arguments book series. And we've just recently launched What's on Africa, which is a listings website. So that's kind of, as well as having our business program, which is aimed at our corporate. So we do a breadth of things. Sorry,
really,
I'm getting...
You've really given it to your portfolio.
Yeah, sorry.
You've really given us the brochure and then some.
Yeah, I am.
It's not about the Royal African Society per se. It's good to know that that's what you do and you're an expert within that arts and culture field. I think fundamentally, and this is what I want with all my guests, is I want the audience to know that, yeah, the people or the person whom I'm speaking to is an expert. And so whatever it is they're advising, they themselves should at the very least look into it, you know, so they can enable themselves. So let's bring it back. Forget what I said.
Yeah, let's forget. Yes.
How does one become, I guess, a program coordinator? And is it different in the arts and culture vertical as it would be for, let's say, a blue chip company corporate?
I would imagine the actual job isn't that different, but how you get to those places may differ itself. So I think with arts and culture, a lot of the time you have to maybe start off with an internship because there's less money within the field. And so the best route to get into working in an arts and culture organization tends to be through doing an internship, getting some contacts, you know, kind of proving your worth. I'm talking, you know, when you're starting fresh out of uni, and you've had no previous experience whatsoever. The downside with that is obviously, you know, the people that come from a more privileged background would be able to do that because some internships aren't necessarily paid, or even if it's voluntary work, you know, not like a kind of structured internship program. But there are, a few schemes that you can look into, kind of get into those positions, even if it's not. So at the moment, you've got Creative Access. And we actually, at the Royal African Society, we're taking on board a Creative Access trainee. And
I'm going to put all of this in the show notes, by the way, any resources and tools we mention in this podcast.
Yeah.
So look out for that on our website.
Perfect. And then we also have a Fed film, I can't even remember what the shorthand is, but it's from the ICO, the Independent Cinema Office. It's a film distribution and sales trainee position. These two programs are aimed at BAME, you know, Black and Ethnic Minority Communities, so candidates. So it's a way of kind of diversifying the pool of, you know, young employees and giving those people access and opportunity, whereby, you know, if you don't have the money to support yourself, you wouldn't then be able to take on those internship opportunities because you'd have to be doing paid work. So then you get into this kind of cycle where you want to get into, break into an industry, but you can't because you don't have the experience. Yeah. But then getting the experience is impossible because you don't have
the financial
Yeah, so it's kind of breaking into that. So yeah, but I mean, my journey into like arts and culture management was kind of, I just fell into it.
Okay, go on.
I mean, I've always been someone who's really appreciated the arts and, you know, really had like this interest in culture and I guess intercultural understanding, being of mixed heritage myself.
You are, aren't you?
Yeah.
What's your mix?
I'm half West Central African from Equatorial Guinea, the only Spanish-speaking country
in Africa.
Yeah. It's between Cameroon and Gabon. and then I'm mostly Spanish. I'd say culturally, I'm probably more Spanish because I was born and raised in Madrid, the capital of Spain. But you know, I've kind of also devoted a lot of my working life to working on Africa-related projects. Yeah, so intercultural understanding, or however you want to put it, I don't know if the it word would be transcultural. But yeah, that's kind of, yeah, you know, kind of celebrating our differences as human beings, but at the same time connecting through our shared humanity. And I think the arts and culture.
That's a soundbite. That's a lovely soundbite.
Really?
Yeah. But you were saying how you got yourself into it.
So I felt, sorry, I'm just going off on a tangent.
That's okay. I'm here to try and bring
you
back.
I'm philosophizing. Yeah. I fell into it because I met someone when I was doing my MA in African Studies at SOAS, the School of Oriental African Studies. And I met this classmate of mine, and so I started working with him and his partner. They had like a small music and, arts production company. And so I started working with them. Sometimes I'd be paid, sometimes I wouldn't be paid.
Right.
But I was lucky enough to be living with my sister and not have to pay rent at the time.
Right.
So that enabled me to then get the experience that I needed. And I remember when I first came out to uni, I was like, I've been living too much in the world of ideas. I want to be brought back down to reality. Yeah. I want to know about admin. I want to know about spreadsheets. I didn't know how to use Excel. So that was really good because I got all of that experience and all of those really basic admin skills that are so essential for you to be an organized event.
Okay.
Manager, so
admin, spreadsheets, day-to-day budgeting.
Yeah,
you're going to go into that a little bit later, aren't you?
Well, I mean, not
necessarily.
yeah, but I mean, it's just having that knowledge then enables you to understand really like what it takes, you know, like to put on a successful event or festival. So
to bring your idea to life.
Yeah, exactly. Because it's all very good and, you know, well to have like all these ideas, but it's about executing them. Yeah. I always say I'm a doer more than a thinker, you know, like
that is true.
Yeah, I just do, like,
I
get on with
you.
It.
You definitely don't shy away from hard work.
Yeah.
Okay, let's get into exactly how you go about putting together a successful event. So we start with the idea, don't we?
Yes. So you start with the idea and you know, if you were to do it in London, it's a city that's like so rich in culture and it's got so many events, like the cultural calendar is already loaded. So there's probably, if there's no event like the one you want to put on, then, you know, like, just go for it.
Is that a good thing if there is no one doing it?
Yeah, because then you're filling a gap. You know, if like I always say, there's no event without an audience, right? Exactly. So if you're certain, or if you've been talking to friends or people in general, and, you know, they've said to you, oh, I'd really like to go to something like that, or, you know, you went to an event or a festival somewhere, I don't know, when you're on holiday, whether it's in another part of the world or, you know, just in another city in the UK, and you don't think that, you know, that's been done in London and it would be a good idea, then you go for it. If there is already an event that's similar, then you have to ask yourself, what am I bringing? You know, why would I want to put on an event that is similar to this other event or festival? You know, what is it that would be unique about what, you know, I'll be doing? Then you obviously have to find a team depending on the scale of the event or festival that you want to do. But there's really like a kind of, there's about five kind of stages to putting the festival on. So first of all, you'd find funding. So you get your fundraising and you find your venue. Then you'd move on to programming. Right. So thinking about...
Just before we do go into the five stages, when you talk about funding, you've got to obviously understand what the budget is. But to know what the budget is, don't you need to understand how much... I mean, sorry, I'm almost...
Yeah.
This is your experience, so forgive me. Because when you go funding, it's like, is that the first stage? Surely not.
What I'm trying to say is, yeah, so you have the idea and you know the scale of what you want to do or you aim to do, and then you go out and look for the funding. So you would have come up with a budget,
right,
of some sort. But obviously then you scale down depending on, or scale up depending on how much money, much funding you get for it. Now, bear in mind that with arts and culture events, you generally, especially if you're doing an international, you know, where you're bringing international guests over, you very rarely make it even. I mean, the box office revenue is just like a kind of a very small percentage of... I know. It's a very small percentage of what the whole budget is. So in terms of expenditure, you're looking at flights for those international guests, you're looking at accommodation, you're hopefully will get your venue in kind. That's the one thing, you know, you need to look at. You could also get flight sponsors, so get an airline on board to give you like an X amount of flights from you know, like in our case, from different parts, different countries in Africa. You could also get a drink sponsor in place to, you know, provide the drinks for the opening and closing nights or your major events. So that sort of thing. But so once you've come up, so let's say, okay, you want to do like a 3-day festival and you want to invite around 20 international guests, and then you'd also look for UK-based talent.
Yeah.
Which would, you know, be quite considerably cheaper. But yeah, so you put your rough budget together, then you look for the funding, and then you would, after you look for the funding, you start to really program the, you know, kind of think, okay, well, you know, we could have this panel on, I don't know, like, you know, kind of women writers who focus on...
So you start talking about the subjects and topics.
Yeah. Yeah, based on those conversations that you think will kind of, you know, hit a nerve, you know, if you're... point of view, you know, like what are the sort of things that, you know... Because when you're programming, you can't really just be kind of too, what's the word, would it be narcissistic or elitist, where you're thinking, you know, like, oh, this is really interesting. You have to ask yourself, would this be something that an audience would be interested in?
Hey guys, before we return to the episode, I just wanted to say I appreciate you listening. And if you'd like to get involved, then please visit www.blackticulate.com for more information. Now let's get back to the episode.
do you distill that then, just out of interest in terms of content?
Well, you just know your audience, and you know, again, you look at what's out there, what, you know, kind of people are looking at. So, for example, like, you know, there's some people who don't really rate Nollywood as you know, kind of quality African cinema.
Right.
And okay, some of, and you know, I mean, even the term Nollywood is kind of, you know, it's evolving. But some of the films may not have the best production values, but people still really, really enjoy them.
Yeah.
You know, and so you have to like cater to those audiences, because you know, the Nigerian diaspora in London and the UK, but especially in London, is huge.
Yeah.
So if you're going to have an African film festival and you don't program any films that cater to those audiences, then you're kind of not, you're missing the point. So you want to build up your audiences so that you know, they come to your event or festival.
For sure.
So that's, you know, so when you're programming, really, you have to be thinking of how you are going to build your audiences. You kind of go on to marketing and PR, which is where basically you're trying to spread the word about your festival. And then there's the actual delivery of the event. And then you'd move on to evaluation. And based on the feedback that you get from audiences and participants alike, then you can improve the event for the following edition, if it's an ongoing, you know, like event, whether it's annually or, so that would be really...
You made that sound really simple, Shaya.
It is that simple.
But there's got to be challenges, hasn't there? I mean, like, what are the challenges?
Well, challenges would be mainly finding the money.
The money.
For the event. That's a big challenge. And I think, you know, depending on kind of the climate, you know, the funding climate, it may be that you put in a grant for, you know, either the Arts Council.
Oh, okay.
Or,
you can go by the Arts Council.
Yeah, the Arts Council has the arts grants for the arts program. We've applied for that for Africa Rights. So, you know, there are ways in which you can... you know, raise those funds. And it's also to do with, you know, like how you pitch the event to different, also maybe even private donors.
Okay.
You know, like if you're looking at companies that would want to have exposure with those audiences that you are going to attract, and you can guarantee like a minimum number of, you know, kind of, what do you call them? Is it impressions?
Yeah. In the digital world.
So, you know, it's those kind of things. When you're looking at your fundraising strategy, you want to also match your potential funders or sponsors with your event. You just can't go to, like, any random company. You have to also do your research and think, you know, what companies or maybe even, like, philanthropies or individuals might be interested in such an event.
Yeah.
But it's a but very
predominantly, you're saying the funding is often the issue.
Yeah, it's the sustainability of the funding. So you may get funding for 1 year, but then the next year you have to start from scratch. And so really, you know, trying to build long-term relationships with some of your sponsors would be the best way to do, but it's not easy.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you this from experience. So, I mean, that's one, you know, sustainability of an event, because like I said, you don't break even just from your box office returns. So that's
one. So why
that's
do
one.
That? If there's no real financial...
Because you're doing it for the love.
For the love.
Literally. Sorry. You're doing it for the love. You're doing it to perhaps, I mean, in our case, for Africa Rights, you know, there's just such a... Oh.
Wow.
What is there? I think we've got a little one who wants to say something.
He's saying, you're not doing it for the love, man.
No, you're not doing it for the love. You should do it to support me. No, I mean... It's really about, you know, just kind of giving exposure to all of that talent, to all of that richness, to to those writers, and you know, hopefully developing then like an appreciation for African arts and cultures in you know, in my case.
Okay, so fundamentally, it's all about funding, Shayla. But are there
major challenge?
Major
that's
challenge.
The main one. Okay. But then, in terms of just the event itself, then you're always going to have to be quite resourceful and I guess not panicky. Do you know what I mean? Because there's a lot of things that can go wrong, and if you panic, then you can't think about what the solution would be. A good example would be like, you know, a guest failing to get their visa on time if they're coming from a different continent, like it's in our case. That can be, you know, especially if it's like, I don't know, the director for the opening night film.
Right.
You know, and how do you navigate that? Well, you could also maybe think about like having a Skype kind of conversation. Right, you know, okay. Like you need to think of like solutions.
Contingency plans, yeah, for sure.
And if you panic, then it's very, very difficult to think of solutions because you're stuck on the... you know, sugar. Not to like swear on this program. And then there's other things like, you know, more logistical problems, like things not arriving on time again, or, you know, getting the wrong number of, you know, for an order you placed, whether it's, you know, wine glasses or, but, you know, those are like more logistical things. And there's always a way out. I mean, you know, there's never something that's like, unsolvable in my view anyway. Yeah. Even if a film doesn't get to you on time, then what you can do is like, you know, if for whatever reason you can find a slot later in the week, I mean, this has actually happened to us, then you reprogram that film and then you put it out on all your, you know, you send out your newsletters, all your social media, you reimburse those who bought the tickets for the initial program slot to, you know, come and then tell them, you know, you can come for the next one. Yeah. So there's always a way of working around a problem, I find anyway. And I think that's the kind of attitude you need to have when you're...
Is that unique to someone like you?
I think I'm an eternal optimist.
Okay. Well, and, which is funny, because you said something to me earlier in regards to how your personal life can certainly affect your professional life. And from an event organizer's POV, I don't know how I always say the word POV, but...
point of view.
It's so much easier. can you explain more about that, expand on that?
What I meant before, when I was talking to you earlier, mentioning the personal related to the professional, was that I think a lot of the time our own personal traumas stop us from realizing our full potential.
Okay.
What, meaning...
Yeah, please, expand.
You can only really like fully realize yourself when you've kind of gone through, in my opinion anyway, this is what I've experienced personally, when you have healed to some degree from like whatever childhood traumas you may have suffered. Like, I mean, I have had a lot of issues in terms of insecurity or like self-worth.
Okay. I feel like we all suffer that to a certain degree.
Yeah, some fair? People more than others.
Yeah, okay.
But not feeling like you're good enough. And so it's interesting because I am a doer, and I think that's part of also linked to my lack of confidence, you know, like you want to do to prove that you can do it. But I would, like, I'm not the kind of person who would ever, like, fake it till I make it. Like, I would never be able to do that. Like, I'd always have to be, like, you know, start from the bottom or do it and then feel like, okay, I've gained this.
Once you're confident in that stage,
then I can move on to the next. But also, like, you know, kind of going through that healing process, it liberates you to see things a bit more clearly, to kind of really accept yourself and know who you are and what you want, essentially. Does that make sense, or am I being too...
No, I get it. I mean, I think fundamentally you've got to know what your strengths and weaknesses are.
Yeah.
And you've also got to know, I guess, your drivers.
Yeah.
You know, in order for you to then apply that professionally. Yeah. How do you identify a good event organizer? You know, and those who are listening, how can they see that in themselves possibly? Because if they've not considered it, but yet they're everything that you are, say for instance, And you're phenomenal at your job, hence you're on Blacktaculate. You are Shayla, without a shadow of a doubt, to the point where I believe you've been nominated for... Do you want to throw that in the middle? Let's give you some kudos, give you some props.
Please. For the Women for Africa Awards.
For Africa Awards.
Big up.
Big up, mother. But do you know what I mean? How do you identify that? Because you've got a team. You know, you've got people underneath you, and you're teaching them, you're training them.
Yeah.
Can you see those who will make it and those who won't? You don't name names, by all means.
No, I mean, I've got a very strong team.
Yeah, you do.
And, you know, I'm not really so much training them. It's hard for me to answer that because I can't really give you the profile of an events organizer. I think everyone's different. We're all individuals.
Yeah,
so I think
sure.
What I can say is that there are skills that you need to develop.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's put it that way, okay. As opposed to like, you need to be this, because it's quite, I don't like to be reductionist, like, you know. So you would definitely need to develop like basic admin skills, because even if you're going to be like boss, you're going to have to know what the admin person is doing for you to be able to monitor. So definitely develop like good organizational skills, good communication skills, good people skills. I mean, you know, people have to be able to work well with you. You have to be kind and not really kind of take people for granted, right? So that if someone does you a favor and you can return the favor, then do, by all means, like, you know, develop those relationships. And in my case, I just liked, you have to be a strong team player. I like to work in a team. You know, there's jobs that require a more solitary kind of...
discipline, I guess.
Discipline.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
If you're a writer, then you need to kind of hide away and write. But with, you know, putting on an event, it's pretty much a team effort.
Okay, Shayla. Well, honestly, you've given us a lot of gems, and I'm really grateful for having you on this platform. We definitely have to get you back again. So... You're humble, to say the least. I mean, I know you personally. And you don't see yourself as successful, do you? Or do you?
I think I'm starting to realize that, you know, because I've got a wealth of experience, that I'm good at what I do. Success is... It's not so... I look at it more holistically. So I'm not just solely focused on my profession. And I know that this is, you know, kind of the thing that we're talking about, you know, me as an events manager or arts and cultural manager. I think success for me is accepting myself, you know, loving myself, you know, enjoying life, looking in the mirror and being happy with what I see. That is more success to me.
Right.
As opposed to being like necessarily the best at what I do, which I always want to do my best, but am I the best? You know, who am I to say? So that's kind of, that would be how I would measure success, you know, in a more holistic way, if that makes sense.
No, it does. So what is next for you then?
So now,
how can we keep you accountable so we come back to you 6 months down the line?
So what's next for me is going back to work as a mother.
Yay!
So it'll be interesting. So I'm going to go back first on a part-time basis, and then I'll do, you know, my full-time role.
Okay, so next for you is getting back to work. And then is there anything that, you know, my listeners potentially can contact you with? I mean, I almost want to give you the open mic. Is there anything that I haven't asked that I've overlooked? Mm-hmm. Any advice that you haven't given and you wish you had said?
This is
free reign.
Okay. So just maybe, especially for those people who doubt themselves, you know, for them to like just really start to work on believing on themselves. And you know, because if you don't believe in yourself and what you're doing, then it's going to be very, very difficult for you to actually succeed. So you have to kind of build that self-esteem and that confidence to do what you want to do and love doing. And, you know, you may not be excellent at first, But then, you know, like that comes with experience. But if there's something that you've identified as something that you want to do, first of all, you need to believe that you can do it.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you can't start. So that's what I would say. And just, you know, we're all unique beings and we all have something to offer. So that would be my piece of advice, really, for everybody.
Okay, so how can we get in touch with you personally or maybe via work?
Preferably via work. Okay. Or on Twitter. I'm on Twitter. You can tweet at me, which is SHEILARUIZ. That's my Twitter handle. And so my name is pronounced Shayla, but spelled like Sheila. And so Shayla Ruiz, at Shayla Ruiz, that's my Twitter handle. And then if you go onto the Royal African Society website, you know, there's like contact details there for everyone in the team, not just for me. So, so check us out and come to Africa Writes, which is coming up in July, 1st to the 3rd of July. And then Film Africa, which will be early November. So, do come to those events and join us for any other events.
Okay. Well, guys, I think you can join me in saying that it's been an absolute pleasure having Shayla and little one.
Hey, guys. We really appreciate you listening, and if you have any feedback, please leave it in the comment section below. Also, all the info about the guests, the links and the resources we speak about will be in the description below. And last but not least, please, please, please do get in touch if you can teach us how you do what it is you do. Because after all, Blacktickulate is all about empowering and upskilling the community. Thanks, guys. You're the best. See you soon.